Good evening. I'm Ken Wells. Welcome to Wheels Along the Road, brought to you by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles, Pennsylvania's Transportation History Museum. We're all about vehicles and vehicle manufacturers, and this area's people who helped make transportation history right here in southeastern Pennsylvania. And if that's of interest to you, then you're in the right place tonight, here with Wheels Along the Road. We hope you'll pick up the telephone anytime during the program and become a part of the program. In the hour ahead, we will once again call on Dan Olson to bring us some of the bits and pieces of information that his research reveals, things too good to be called trivia, things that sometimes make us say, well, what do you know? Welcome, Dan. Good to have you aboard
tonight.
Thanks
for having me again.
Okay, good. And then we'll do some tech talk with our specialist, Mike Inessa, owner of the automobile restoration business in Pottstown known as Wheels in Motion. So welcome, Mike. Good to have you back again tonight.
Thank you, Ken. Glad to be here.
And tonight, the guest segment on Wheels Along the Road brings back a gentleman with so much interesting knowledge of racing, racing cars, local tracks, drivers, records, you name it, that we could feature him on every edition of Wheels Along the Road if he was willing. Herb Butz, looking forward to talking with you this evening.
Thank you very kindly, Ken.
And we're very pleased that you're spending some time with us tonight. If you want to be a part of the program, like I say, pick up the telephone. Give us a call. Call us here in the VCTV studios at 610-378-0426. Dan Olson, cars, trucks, aftermarket goodies. What's in the what-do-you-know bag of tricks tonight? I know you always have something a little out of the ordinary. Something unusual, maybe some old stuff, maybe some new stuff. What is it tonight?
Usually old stuff.
Usually old
stuff.
Yeah,
yeah. That's what gets me interested. Today, what I'm going to be talking about is drag racing, and going back to the 60s. and you go back in the 60s, the factories were very, very involved with drag racing. And I'm going to be talking about the Chrysler Corporation and how involved they were back in like 1965. And what they did back then is the way NHRA, which was the hot rod group back then, the way they had it, if you wanted to have a factory super stock car, you had to build at least 100 of a vehicle. So Chrysler built 101 Plymouths and 101 Dodgers, and they were lightweights. They had lightweight front ends to them, like aluminum maybe, and different other aluminum lightweight parts. And they were fairly successful with it, but Ford comes out, and Ford has a big racing engine that they're putting in their cars, which is the 427 overhead cam engines. Chrysler came back with the Hemis. Well, then Ford goes with the smaller wheelbase cars like the Mustangs and also Comets, the Mercury Comets. So they went to a smaller car with just the same powerful engine, or equally as powerful as Chrysler did. So what Chrysler did, instead of going to smaller cars yet, like the Dodge Darts and such, they came out with a different thing. And back then, the National Hot Rod Association had a rule that you could alter your wheelbase up to 2 inches. And Chrysler was moving their wheelbase around 2 inches, and Ford and everybody else was. But then Chrysler thought, well, let's just try something else here. And they ended up moving their rear wheelbase 15 inches forward and their front wheelbase 10 inches forward. And before we get any further, if you could show the first picture here. There you go. That is a Plymouth Super Stock, okay? That's a non-altered wheelbase car. That's the way they were running. If it was altered, it was only 2 inches, okay? And that's a restored car there. That was based on a 65 Plymouth Satellite, two-door sedan. And that's pretty much the way they were running back there in early 1965. And But then Chrysler comes out, as I say, they started moving things around with their alter wheelbase car. And the reason they kept these larger cars instead of going to the Dodge Darts and the Plymouth Barracudas is they figured this is more marketable. These were the cars that were selling this body style to the general public. And so they stuck with these and just moved the wheelbases. And the first actual alter wheelbase car was Dick Landy, who was a famous driver back then from California, took a Hemi sedan and started moving things around. It wasn't factory authorized. He did it on his own, kind of changed things. And he moved the rear axle forward, and then the whole stock front suspension he moved forward also. And he just kind of was experimenting, and I guess people at Chrysler saw that he was doing rather successful, so they built their own prototype, Chrysler did, in 65. And they built a Dodge Coronet into this altered wheelbase. Now, if you show the next picture, there you go. There is the aftermarket product. This is a gentleman called Bud Faubel. He's out of Chambersburg, Pennsylvania. He had that. And both of those cars, or both of those pictures, I believe are the same car. Obviously, one's unpainted and one is painted. And you can just see the rear wheel, how much forward it was, because there's a huge overhang behind that rear axle. You can't see real well, but the front wheel opening, we'll say, for the tires is almost up to where the front bumper is on those things. And rumor had it, he got his car, for some reason, wasn't delivered, and rumor has it he went to Detroit and picked that up and drove it home. And I can imagine those things were race cars, and driving a Hemi engine race car from Detroit all the way to Chambersburg, Pennsylvania was quite an interesting ride. I guess he used earplugs. But anyway, so these cars, they started as a Dodge Coronet, as you just saw there, or a Plymouth Belvedere hardtop in white. And when I say in white, it was a color, but that was just a term they used for a race car without much chrome on it, and that was your basic race car. They were manufactured in Los Angeles, actually. They created the bodies of this car. They were assembled in Los Angeles without the fenders, hood, or deck lid. Then they were shipped to a place in the LA area, the Los Angeles area, called Automation Industries, and they did a term, and I love this term, and it's called chemical milling. And basically what they did, they acid dipped the body to make the whole body very light. That they lost 200 pounds just by doing that. They did several other things. As I said, they moved the front wheel or the rear wheels up 15 inches, and so on and so forth. But I'm kind of getting ahead of myself. After the chemical milling, then they shipped the cars to an organization in Troy, Michigan called Amble Wagon Corporation. And they're the ones who actually did the moving of the axles and the wheels and such, and they did the serious work there. Now, Amble Wagon was famous for making ambulances and hearses out of standard station wagons. So they knew something about the metalwork that would go into cars such as this. As I said, again, the rear end got moved up 15 inches. They took the floor pan out from where the rear seat was, and they kind of cut things and moved things, and they reconfigured it. The front end, they moved up 10 inches. They needed new side rails up front, and they needed new suspension pieces and stuff. The torsion bars, they had it lengthened 10 inches. They had to lengthen the steering column, and just a lot of small things like that. Well, now you have a car that the wheelbase has been changed like that, but I think I mentioned that they originally were shipped without front fenders, hood, or deck lid. Well, another company called Plaza Fiberglass Company out of Dearborn, Michigan, they came up with the the body pieces. So there was fiberglass front fenders, front doors, the liftoff hood, the front bumper, the rear deck lid, also the instrument panel was all fiberglass. And they had Chrysler part numbers. You could walk into your Chrysler dealer and buy these. I guess it wasn't real simple as just walking in and buying them, but they were available to the general public. The windshield was made out of Lexan. The side windows were made out of plexiglass, and they were fixed in place. They couldn't roll down or anything. The backlight or the rear window, that was also plexiglass. The total weight of the finished car was 2,800 pounds. Now, originally, those cars were about 3,200 pounds, so they lost 400 pounds with all this changing and everything. Now, National Hot Rod Association had a weight limit of 3,200 pounds, so they had 400 pounds to put back on the car, but the trick was they could place it anywhere they could. Most of it went towards the rear of the car for better rear traction. They stuck the battery in the rear trunk. Underneath the gas pan, they put a 100-pound weight. It was just a thick piece of sheet metal. You wanted all that weight in the back for better weight transfer. The engines were the 426 Hemi race engines. They had aluminum heads. They had magnesium cross-ram intake manifolds. The cars, as I said, had the battery was in the back, the skid plate was in the back. They only used one bucket seat, so a lot of maneuvering around of where they wanted to wait on these. Transmission, you could get a four-speed manual or you could get an automatic. And that automatic was so consistent and so popular that they were nicknamed Dial a Win. And a lot of these drivers were pretty well known with the automatics there. In April of 65, some of these teams started putting Hillborn fuel injection systems in it. And they had different kinds of fuel injection systems with the cars. Chrysler's total cost was $120,000. Now, this was for 12 cars. They made 6 Dodgers and 6 Plymouths, and $120,000. So that comes to $10,000 a car, which today's standards, that's not much, but in 65, I guess that was big bucks. Several big name teams were there. You could show the next picture, please. And that's one of them. That's the Roger Lindemood car, Color Me Gone. And it's not real easy to see because it is a black and white picture, but you can see the tremendous overhang on the rear of the car, and you can see the front wheels right up to the bumper there, and that's how they did that. That was an automatic transmission car. You can tell by the injection stacks coming out of the hood. The automatic transmission ones had 13 or 14 inch long stacks, whereas the standard transmission only had 7-inch long ones. There was another car. There you go. That is a Bill Fling car. Actually, I saw that car at Carlisle a couple years ago. It was on display. And that is not a hardtop. All the other ones were hardtops. This was a sedan here. Again, automatic transmission, because you look at the size of the stack. See, they're about 13 or 14 inches long. I don't know what the idea was with different length stacks, but that's an easy way to remember. But that's the Yankee Peddler car, and that was from Connecticut. They also used this as a test car because some of the hardtops were flexing so much with the lightweight bodies, they were running into problems. So since this was more of a post type of two-door sedan, it was a little stiffer body here. You could show the next picture, please. Thank you. And that's also at Carlisle. That car is another Dodge, and there's no hood scoop or anything there, so it probably doesn't have any injection unit. Actually, I have a feeling it's a brand new car or a brand new made car, and I saw a couple of them for sale at Carlisle that year, and I saw a couple more on display, such as the Yankee Peddler car. And it's interesting about this car is you know, I said it's probably just manufactured recently. You can go online, and I have it here somewhere. You could show this, and I have right here in my hand a copy of Chrysler's technical report that they made, and you can go online and find this, and you can read everything in it, and you can see it says confidential there, but you know, I made copies of this, and it just has all the things that you need to do to make your own altered wheelbase Mopar out of a 1965 car, and I thought that was pretty cool that you can do it, and it is quite technical, but if you were building a car, this is your little handbook here. Anyway, these cars were so successful, and they were kind of odd. The racing association didn't really have a class to put them in, so they kind of invented a class there, and they called it Match Bash, and they basically just match race. And all along, Chrysler was thinking that's what would have happened anyway. That's why they kind of like forsook the rules, and they just went on, built whatever they felt like building. They figured we can just go have match races around the country and get all this exposure and sell billions of cars. Last picture, please. There you go. There's another one. That's Dandy Dick Landy and his Dodge, and he's doing a wheel stand, and I figure that's like as good as it gets, I guess. Maybe it's not the fastest way if you only have the two wheels on the ground, but that's pretty spectacular, and that's what people pay tickets for, to see that. And if you look above the right or above the rear wheel well, you see a little crinkle there under the L of Landy. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if that's just the body flexing because it was very thin, or he comes up so hard that the rear bumper hits the ground and it kind of bends everything. But they were kind of flimsy cars, but that was quite an era. And that is the beginning of what they call funny cars. They saw those things and they call them funny cars, which evolved into these fiberglass things that don't resemble a street car at all today. But that was a neat little era back then, 1965, and then it evolved after that. And that's the beginning of funny cars. Now, I wanted to mention a couple things before. Do I have another minute or two?
Thank you. Got a half a minute, sure.
Okay.
But you know, before you go in, Dan,
yes.
Let me make a comment. You mentioned $10,000 a copy for this.
Yes,
things.
Yes.
I was thinking back, the best car you could buy in the middle 60s, a Cadillac Packard type car, was about $6,000.
Mm-hmm.
So, and Chevys, yeah, and Fords and all were selling in the 2000s.
Yeah. Well, I think that $10,000 was without the engine too. So
okay,
you know, that probably bumped it up. Some
and Lexan, you know, we think of Lexan for scientific view plates and things like, mm-hmm, that. But in an automobile, that kind of plastic was, yeah, very dear at that time when it was,
yeah, back then. Yeah.
Yeah. Interesting. Yeah. Go ahead and take. Now I've used 15 of your seconds. You got 15 seconds.
Well, this is like a museum thing here, okay? About 5-6 weeks ago, we had a reunion of Boyertown workers, former Boyertown auto body workers, at the museum, and it was great and really enjoyed it. And there was two guys there that should be mentioned, that they brought their vehicles out to this program, and they had them parked out front, and I just want to give them recognition, and hopefully I can say this one right, is Hot Rod Rob Gabrielek. Okay, I hope I said your name right. And he has a 1948 Bondbred Boyertown truck. And those of you who watch every month can remember 3-4 months ago, I actually mentioned about this truck out there, and we finally got a hold of him. He brought this truck, great looking truck, okay. Now, if I thought ahead of time, I would have had a picture to show you, but I didn't think that. And there was also Rob Donley, and he had a former fire truck that had a Boyertown body, and he's from the Lebanon area. And I thank both of these guys for doing this. I thought that was kind of a neat little display that they had just parked out by the curb. And another thing, Rob is taking his truck out to Bonneville to the Salt Flats this year, and he's planning on sending pictures back to the museum, and hopefully we can have something where you know, people can get into our website, hopefully, and look at pictures there. And I also wanted to mention, and I'd be yelled at if I didn't mention this, there's geezers at the Grove. If you could focus in on this, please. And this is a show, there you go, Geezers Reunion at the Grove. And you can see right here in the middle here, it's funny cars. Now, they're funny cars from the early 70s. They're not quite of what I was talking about. But you can see it's July 2nd and 3rd of this year. And it's just a bunch of nostalgia dragsters going to be there. You going to be there, Mike?
Very good. Yep.
Very good event. Mike's going to be there. So
it's a good event. I recommend it.
Run out there. And, yeah, I went to it last year, and it was kind of interesting. I kind of enjoyed that. So.
Yep.
And that's it. Now I'm done.
Good, Dan. Good, Dan. We know Tech Talk is a part of the program where we take time to look under the hood, to find out how things work, to learn some better ways of doing things, to discover new tools and techniques. And Mike Inessa from Wheels in Motion, what do you have for us tonight? You got a panel there. What is that?
A little bit of everything.
A little bit of everything. Okay.
A little bit of everything tonight. I'm going to talk a little bit about buying your classic car, or in fact, a used car, a modern car even. I always try to do Tech Talk on things that I get asked a lot, or I get in that position. And a lot of people, you'd be amazed how many people come to me with horror stories after the fact when they bought a classic car, antique car, or again, even a used modern car. The thing is that a lot of times cars are purchased for a different reason. You get emotional, you get excited, you get on a whim. That's usually a bad sign. If you see a classic car or, again, a modern used car, you need to evaluate that car. I know I've talked about this before from time to time, but I feel that it's a thing that we have to remind each other of, that when you're looking for cars, that you have to research that particular vehicle. 1 year difference in a vehicle. Like if you see a 70 car and there's a 71 and you're comparing those two, you can't do that. 1 year makes a difference of thousands of dollars. Engine size makes a difference of thousands of dollars. Correct engine, numbers matching. All things that you heard me say before, but it's, again, I got to stress how important it is. I see a lot of people make mistakes and they wouldn't have to. The color of the car, the year of the car, the options it has, how many owners it has, how many body panels were replaced. It all weighs into the factor of how much that car is worth. And sometimes you'll tend to maybe ask the friend for his advice, and I don't recommend that unless the friend's an expert on that model. It's best to get a professional, pay a professional, or you know, in my case, if you would make an appointment, stop by the shop, we look at the car and we give you our opinion. If it's something that we are not familiar with, we'll research it, just like they do for real estate, just like they do for anything. Let's face it, not everybody's an expert on Mustangs, Camaros, T-Birds, Model A's. So you kind of find somebody that says, hey, this guy's into Corvettes. He knows that emblem should be here or that stripe should be there. And when you're spending the cost to buy these cars today, it seems like a must that you take the time and research this vehicle. One guy doesn't know everything. One shop doesn't know everything. But if you go to a professional that does it for a living, if they're good, they can usually direct you in a direction. Don't be in a hurry. There's plenty of classic cars out there. And more time than not, I see people buy cars that just they could have done better if they'd have taken their time. You hear that word rare all the time. There's some rare cars out there, but it might be only rare to the person selling it. It might be that his sales pitch. And the best one that I can use is like, and I'm guilty of it, 10 years ago, a 65 Corvette Coupe or a mid-year Corvette Coupe with air conditioning was rare. It's rare in Pennsylvania. But in Florida and California, most of them have air conditioning. So somebody might charge you thousands of dollars because this car has air conditioning. it's actually a local rarity, not a national rarity, for example. Remember, we talked tonight, you saw my 54 Corvette that I had, very rare car in Pennsylvania, very common car in Florida or California. I mean, in 1954, the price of that car, you had to have money and you wanted to use it. So where did the car get sold? California, Florida, fair weather states. Who would buy a car like that in Pennsylvania and put snow tires on it? Nobody. So again, there's a good, you know, that rare word you have to really analyze and take your time. And I just see a lot of people make mistakes and I feel bad for them, but it's too late. Once they buy it, they come to me and they're already buried in the car, and it's a quickie paint job, or it's something that somebody just spruced up to sell, and they ask money, big money for it. And another point is that the value of that car, and this is a good one, and I've heard it a million times in my life, people will come up, they'll look at a car, and they'll immediately say, that's too much money. And they didn't even bother looking under the hood. They didn't see if it was numbers matching. They didn't see if it was a stick shift, if it had air conditioning, and what the car, you know, the know-it-all guy walking through the crowd will comment that that particular car is overpriced. And he didn't even crawl under it yet. And that's a good one that I just looked at. I looked at a car recently that looked good. It was a fair price. And it was more of a driver cruise night car. I went and looked at it. And paint's decent, chrome's decent, very presentable car. Inspected until I bent over and looked underneath it. And the body mounts were gone. Everything was tar, pitch, pop rivets. The frame was rusted. But really, if you would not have laid on the ground and got dirty, that I was very impressed with the car from the top side. You know, that's how they dolled it up to sell it. You know, it looked presentable. I could drive this to cruise night and be cool on Saturday night, but once you lay under it, it basically needed a frame-up restoration. So walk away from it. Look for another one. Look for a better example. My dad always used to tell me when I was a kid, when you're buying a car, and it's a pretty good rule of thumb, when you're buying a car, it has to have something going for it, like a nice interior but needs paint, or a nice paint job but has a blown engine. Usually, when you find a car that needs motor, trans, paint, rust, interior, unless it's a very rare example, it's not worth getting involved in, unless it's you know, something that's worth a lot of money when you're done. And again, you could always find another rare example that's not as rough and probably put money in the bank. A lot of guys tend to think, well, I can do the work myself and save money. That's true, but we're all limited. We can only do so much. And what happens is then is they do the work, they do their best, and a lot of guys do a great job. But did you ever see cars advertised as like an amateur restoration? That's a car that's very nice. It's a cruise night car, but it's not going to go to Hershey. So the end result is you put a lot of time and money into this car, and it still falls a couple thousand or 10,000 short because it wasn't the important parts weren't done by a professional. So there's a lot to buy in these, especially the older cars, and like I said, your newer cars. If you're looking for a 2003, do research. That particular year might be a bad year. 2004 is more money, but it could be a better make and model. So if you tend to see a used car ad and you kind of get excited because it's cheap, do a little research before you go jumping in and find out that you made a mistake. And of course, for the new cars, they have Carfax, and they have you know, different things available that can tell you more. I think it goes back into the 80s, but it doesn't go back into the, you know, the old 50s and 60s or older. So get the, like I said, the right professional look at the right car. If you're looking at a Mustang, try to get somebody that knows Mustangs. If you get somebody like me that maybe doesn't know everything about a Model T Ford, I can point you in the right direction. Hemmings, internet, there's a lot of information out there that's in front of you. And it's the best thing to do if you're looking for a car. And as far as the estimate, I said this before, but my son actually came up with this. And I'm going to, when you do buy this car and you expect to get it done, my son wrote this up for me, and we have it hanging at the shop. And a lot of people will say to me, how much does it restore if I buy a Mustang or a Camaro? How much is it? And I'll tell them, well, it varies depending on condition. And usually they'll say, like Camaro, oh, you've done 100 Camaros, you have to know how much it is. No, because every car is different. It's totally, I've never ran into two cars that were the same. So he wrote this little statement, we have it hanging on the wall, about estimating to restore your car. Before you tear them down, you always find surprises. It always costs more when you're restoring antique vehicles. Okay. Now, professional restorations take a lot of time, and like every one of us, our hot rods have lived different lives. So unfortunately, it's hard to give an exact price on restorations. You can give a range, but you can't give it. A lot of people want it down to the last penny, and that's difficult because of just what he said. We've lived different lives, the cars you buy live different lives, and unfortunately, until they're ripped down, sandblasted, and tore apart, you never know what you'll find. So that's my little speech on buying used cars. And tied in with that is I have a panel laying in front of me here that's off the Challenger that we're restoring at the shop. And there's this, have any of the viewers ever heard of a mill gauge? They're usually digital and they're usually expensive and they're not within the reach of the normal, they're $300, $400. There's a couple of cheaper ones on the market, like this one's about $30, and Eastwood sells one that's, I believe, about $8 or $10. And I just wanted to show, for example, if you're going to buy a used car, if the camera could zoom in on this, I'm going to try to do it for you. You can calibrate these, and it's basically a magnet. And I don't know if the camera can zoom in, but you pull this magnet up on this piece of metal. There you go. And you'll see, let me turn it for you, there's numbers on there. If you read those numbers, it's kind of hard for me, but...
Well, it's sort of like a tire gauge,
isn't it? It's sort of like a tire gauge. Yeah. Now, all of a sudden, it's going to leave go. When it leaves go, you try to read that last number you saw, which I think is about an 8. That means there's 8 mils of paint on this panel that we painted. That includes primer, that includes paint, and clear coat on this particular panel. So, and that's good. A new car, they're thin. New cars are thin. They probably go from about 4 to 8 mils. There's not much paint. That's why if you get a scratch and you rub through very easily. On a typical restoration, because of the process we do and most shops do, you're probably looking at about maybe 11 to 14 mils because you do have some build primer and you do have, you know, a thicker paint job that's going to last. And when you're looking at cars that use cars again, if it has excessive Bondo or it has a spot, this gauge isn't going to stick. It's going to be like going to this table, which would be, you know, bad. So if you stick it down at the bottom of the fenders where you know the car rusts, you know, and it don't stick, you know that there's putty work there. So again, looking at a used car or a classics car, you can't see through the paint. You don't know if the body work was done right. This is a cheap little tool that you can pick up. I wouldn't recommend going around and sticking it on cars at car shows because people might get upset, but if you're a hot, interested buyer and you ask the owner, hey, can I use this just to check, he shouldn't have a problem with it. And another thing, when the word Bondo is a kind of a generic word, would be spray filler or polyester, that's more professional. All the classic cars have some level of Bondo in them or spray poly. The thing is, to get the car straight, you have to do that. But if it's thick or if they use it to fill rust holes, that's bad. But if they use it to level out the panels, that's acceptable and it will last forever if it's no more than a few mils thick. So that's a little thing I brought on mill gauges, which you can use if you're looking for a hot rod. This one, if your camera could zoom in, is a wet mill gauge. And if any of you guys do body work at home, or even just priming little parts, this is a device that, like the book will say, apply 2 mils of primer. Well, what's 2 mils? I mean, 2 mils to you and 2 mils to me, I don't even know sometimes. It's almost, you know, I don't know how much paint's on there. So what you do is you paint the panel and then you drag these teeth, which will start down here from 1 to 6. You would drag that across the wet paint, just the test panel, of course. And you'll get an idea like, oh, one coat is 2 mils. And you'll be able to do your paint work, your primer work and stuff. So you don't wind up with 20 mils of primer on a car and then it cracks or peels. Especially today, it's very critical on mil thickness as far as in longevity and future problems of it sinking or giving you defects in your bodywork. So that's two examples of mil gauges that I decided to bring along. In connection with buying a used car, you could use that if you have doubts of bodywork or excessive paint work. And the last one I'll tell is about a friend that brought me a trunk lid, and I told the guys out before the show, when I painted it and blended it. It was just a couple repairs, and when I was done, it kind of moved on me. You could see some sand scratches, and you could see some imaging. It wasn't my work. What happens is the chemicals from the paint go all the way down to the metal. So, and it comes back and it festers whatever's underneath there. Well, after I got done, I checked it with my swell little mill gauge and had 40 mils of paint. 40 mils is like 5 paint jobs. So again, why we never paint over old paint, we always strip. So, yes, Ken?
A mil is a thousandth of an inch, right?
Yes.
40,000, that's a pretty good layer.
That's a lot of paint. And I just have two quick pictures I just wanted to throw in if I have enough time. If you could show the first one, please. It's a business card, I believe. This guy here, tying in with what Dan said, is a local friend of mine. If you guys would go online, he has some really cool pictures of drag cars. And the next one is actually the picture of Kaiser Chevrolet in High Street in the 40s. And the reason I threw that in, because a lot of you folks know that I bought the old Dame Chevrolet or Kaiser Chevrolet body shop. This is not it. This is High Street in Pottstown in the 30s. And I thought that'd be cool just to show you guys. All right?
Good.
That's it for tonight.
Good. Thank you very much, Mike.
Thanks, Ken.
Let's take a moment and see what BCTV's got to say to us tonight.
You're watching Wheels Along the Road on bctv.org. Be informed. Be involved. Be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For more information and other related stories, go to www.bctv.org. Program underwriting is a valuable source of revenue for bctv.org. For more information on how you and your business can become program underwriters, go to www.bctv.org.
Well, if you just tuned us in, welcome to Wheels Along the Road, produced by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles. I'm Ken Wells. Wheels Along the Road is here at this hour each month, so thanks for spending some time with us this evening. Each time Herb Butz has come as a guest on Wheels Along the Road, we learn something about racing, about local tracks, or the drivers, or drivers who built careers here in southeastern Pennsylvania. And when we get the idea that there must have been some remarkable things going on, both on the tracks and in the race car builders' garages. And I wonder, that's my impression. Is this true? Well, let's give Herb a few minutes of this Wheels Along the Road hour, and I'll bet he's going to answer the question. How about it, Herb? Are there some noteworthy racing stuff going on here? There's a leading question. Huh?
No, we actually were the hotspot of racing in all the country. There might be a couple people in California that might argue, but we truly were the hotbed of all racing, the beginning of organized racing, I should say, Ken. It was just outstanding. And I'd like to talk about one of our great local drivers by the name of Russell Snowberger. And if we could put that first graphic up. Russell started racing in 1921, just at the very beginning of organized racing. There's a picture of him. He drove his first race at Harrington, Delaware, where he finished third in the feature in his first time out, and he was bit with a racing bug from that moment on. He then raced locally for several years there, won races at Allentown and other tracks. And in our next graphic here, we have a picture of a big race. This is a picture of the poster for a race on the Pottstown Mile, and this was a 1 mile dirt track, and from what I've been told, it was right on High Street. And this attracted all the major car owners and all the drivers from our era there, and that was one of the premier events in the area there, and one of Russell Snowberger's favorite tracks. In fact, in our next picture, I have a of the track there. These pictures are about 80 or 90 years old. You'll have to excuse it. They lost a little in the transition there, but the top picture is a picture from the infield looking at the grandstand and starter stand. The bottom is a picture looking down the front straightaway from the fourth corner, and you could see at a distance here the grandstand. This track always attracted thousands of people. In fact, this very race, from what I understand, had over 10,000 people in attendance, which was phenomenal.
And this is Pottstown.
Right in Pottstown, right on High Street, Ken.
Interesting.
And again, a mild dirt track. In our next graphic is a picture of the winning car and the winning driver, and that was Russell Snowberger. He just absolutely won, and Russell was starting to get noticed at the national level at this point here. There was a lot of big fish in little ponds, and there was a lot of guys that ran locally. Now he was being noticed at the national level. He followed this victory up with the very first 100-mile championship race at Langhorne Speedway, and that really got everybody's attention there. And in our next graphic, we talk about versatility. Versatility was the name of the game in those days. And here we are at Altoona, Pennsylvania, on the board track. And these board tracks were a phenomena that sprung up. They lasted about 3 or 4 years, most of them. They were built in places like Rockingham, New Hampshire, Laurel, Maryland, Akron, Ohio, as far west as Culver City, California, Woodbridge, New Jersey. And every board track that was ever built had two things in common. They were extremely fast and they were extremely dangerous. Here's a picture of sitting on the pole position, Billy Arnold, who 2 weeks earlier just won the Indianapolis 500 in that very same car. On the outside of the front row is Russell Snowberger in his car. This is a testament to his mechanical and driving skills here, because Billy Arnold's car in those days cost a little more than $35,000 to make. Russell Snowberger's car was $1,450 to make, and that's engine and everything. But that gave you an idea. And here again, he's running with Millers, he's running with Duesenbergs, he's running with some of the foreign engines that people have tried there that were built almost exclusively for racing, but just a testament of his mechanical and driving ability. In our next shot, and again, speaking of versatility, the Studebaker company asked Russell and several other drivers if they would participate in a 24-hour endurance race. And that was done at Atlantic City, on the board track there at Atlantic City, New Jersey. To give you an idea of why those tracks were so fast, the banking was so phenomenal. And in fact, I've had some of the older drivers tell me that if you weren't going forward fast enough, that the rear of the car would tend to slide down. And you had to go just at a certain speed just to maintain the attitude of the car. Studebaker ran this for 24 hours, and for our younger viewers, this was quite a thing in those days, because every car manufacturer wanted to brag about holding the 24-hour records, the top speed records, and so on like that, and they just about cleaned out every existing record for a 24-hour run with passenger cars. Russell realized that these Studebaker engines were pretty good, and we'll talk about that in a little bit here. But in the next photo, we have a picture of the Vanderbilt Cup in New York. This attracted the elite of the world, and I do mean the elite when I say the German teams of Auto Union, Mercedes, the Maseratis, the Alphas, drivers like Rudolf Caracciola, Bernd Rosemeyer, Tazio Nuvolari, Richard Seaman, Giuseppe Farina, our guys, Wilbur Shaw, Rex Mays, Russ Snowberger. And here's a picture of Russell. It's hard to see there, but he's in the top right-hand picture there. He's going by in his Bird Piston Ring Special, which was a car built just for mile tracks and primarily just to go left. He entered the race and finished an incredible 7th overall, which really was, again, another testament. Speaking of versatility, this was a flat asphalt track. So we started on dirt tracks. We started on board tracks. Here's a flat asphalt track, and he ran good on any surface. During this period of time, he started running the national circuit. He ran at tracks like Langhorne, Syracuse, DeCoin, Detroit, Springfield, Milwaukee, Pottsville, Pennsylvania, Williams Grove, and the Indy Dirt Mile in Indianapolis, Indiana, and was making a name nationally. In our next photo, You have a picture of Russell and his pit crew at Indianapolis, and I kept his Indy record a little separate. He actually started running in 1927, but to keep that all in one order there, this is a picture of one of the cars. Russell built most of the cars he drove. Just about every car he built had a stock block engine, which was incredible because, again, he's running against Millers and Doozies that were just built exclusively for racing. His first trip to Indianapolis was as a relief driver in 1927, and he drove there for the first time. In 1928, he came back and he prepared the car for Lou Meyer, who won the Indianapolis 500. Russell qualified in a different car. The car broke. He became a relief driver for Jimmy Gleason, the great Philadelphia driver, and was leading the Indianapolis 500-mile race at the 400-mile mark. Pulled in for a pit stop only to have an overzealous crewman spill water on the mag and kill the engine. But this is incredible there because, again, in his mechanical skills, he prepared the car that eventual three-time Indianapolis winner Lou Meyer won, and again was leading it handily, from what I understand, until that happened. He came back in 1931 with a car that he built from the ground up. He won the pole position, and what really set the racing world on its ear was the fact that it was a straight eight Studebaker engine in the car. He called it a Russell 8 at that point because he added his own personal touches. That qualifying record lasted for the next 54 years, and again, a testament to his mechanical skills. He ran and finished fifth that year, which was incredible. In fact, in the first five tries in Indianapolis, he had five top 10 finishers. He then was in 33, he came back with a credible eighth. In 34, he finished eighth. In between that, the Hupp Motor Company, makers of the Huppmobile, gave him a one-year contract to, in our next photo here, I'll show a car that he built that car, one of the more famous cars. He put a Huppmobile engine, which was a straight eight, a 361 cubic inch straight eight in it, and campaigned throughout the entire United States, drove it in Indianapolis and all the other tracks. The ruling body at that point was three A's. They said for every cubic inch, a car must have an 8-pound weight. Unfortunately, with a 361 cubic inch engine and with ballast added, this car almost weighed 2,700 pounds. And even though weight, as Daniel talked about earlier in the show, weight is the number one killer in all of racing, he still had a credible year with that. And Hupp supplied him with a house to live in, a passenger car at his disposal, use of the factory as far as machine work goes and whatever he needed to produce a winner. They made regular movie commercials, moving picture commercials, which were seen throughout the theaters in the United States, and also radio commercials. Pennzoil was always a big sponsor for Russell, and that was one of his more famous cars there. And in our next shot, when they talk about the expression, the apple doesn't fall far from the tree, Russell's son John, a master metal man, waited for decades to get that car that his father drove in Indianapolis. And here is a picture of it being restored there. When John got it, it had no body. Most of the running gear was gone. And with his meticulous workmanship there, he completely went over that, bringing it back to its former self. The Indianapolis Motor Speedway last year invited John to bring that car to run in the pre-race ceremonies. And that's a picture in the bottom right-hand corner of John and his son crossing the start-finish line at the Indianapolis 500 track. And a testament, like I say, like father, like son right there. In our next photo, we have during the war years, Russell was a dyno. He dynoed P-51 engines during the war years and other engines. And when he wasn't doing that, he was ringing out PT boats on the Great Lakes. Mm-hmm. The man in the middle might look familiar. That's Captain Eddie Rickenbacker, who at that time owned the Indianapolis 500 Speedway. And he put his time in during the war doing that. In our next shot is a picture of Russell. Like most drivers, there were no cars built. They had to use cars that were made before World War II. Although this picture has 1947, he drove this very same car in 1946, qualified for both 46 and 47 with this. This was the sister Maserati to the car that Wilbur Shaw won two 500s in. It was a straight eight, 3-liter, dual supercharged Maserati. He qualified excellently in both races, but had mechanical woes. He brought the car home and after the 47 race, took the Maserati out, put an Offenhauser in it, brought it back in 48, and realized, like so many great drivers, that his time had come, and he stepped out of the car and never drove at the speedway anymore. And in our next photo there was just a picture of one of the beautiful Federal Engineering cars. Russell went to work as a full-time mechanic for Federal Engineering in Detroit, Michigan. They had a series of beautiful cars. This happened to be at Pikes Peak where he won that race, his cars that he prepared seven times, and it was incredible. Our next photo is a shot of Russell himself in one of the last drives, driving a Maserati up the hill. And it's a shame you can't see how much that drops off there, but we talked, Ken and I talked earlier, if you went off the course here, you really went off the course. I mean, it was a 300 or 400 foot drop. In his one of his last drives, he finished fourth in that aged, that very aged Maserati at that point. And in our final photo here is a picture of the Federal Engineering car. These cars were taken, he was the shepherd, Russell Snowberger was the chief mechanic. There were many of these cars. This is at Indianapolis. They were meticulously prepared. And just one more shot left, and that's the apple doesn't fall far from the tree, and that's John Snowberger, his son, got one of these after it was horribly chopped up and used as a sprint car, shortened wheelbase. Just about everything on the car was destroyed, no body. John made that complete body, brought that car back to the luster that had all aluminum body. His father would be proud of that. And he was just an icon in American racing. And if I could quote two people real fast, Lou Meyer, the three-time winner in Indianapolis, said that Russell Snowberger should have won Indianapolis two or three times. And Joe Miller, a driver that we profiled several years ago and a friend and drove at the same time Russell did, said it in three things. He said he was a great driver, he was a great mechanic, and he was an outstanding man.
Wow. We know Herb, that's really interesting. It's interesting to talk about a local guy who's done all these things. Mm-hmm. But we were talking about the Pikes Peak Road. Have you driven that road? A lot of you folks in the audience probably have, because it's still there. It's still basically the same road. And as you go up from Colorado Springs to 14,000 feet or whatever it is, that road, you said it may be several hundred feet down. There's some places,
my God,
there's some places where several thousand feet down. And, you know, if you ever wanted to lose your nerve, that would be the place where you're going to lose it.
I drove it at night.
You drove it at night?
In a motorhome.
Oh, really?
With no guardrail.
Yeah, oh, no guardrail, absolutely.
It was something.
It's an exciting drive.
Unbelievable.
It's exciting. Hey, there's a lot going on around the Bordertown Museum of Historic Vehicles. Some of those programs and activities and projects that are mainly the responsibility of our five-member staff. But most of the things that are accomplished are also helped out in one way or the other by volunteers, the educational programs. We rely on folks for so many different things. Folks like you who want to get involved, lend a hand, have some fun, meet some real challenges, and go home feeling good about their accomplishments. For example, at the end of this month, June, we'll be preparing several vehicles to go to the wonderful Kutztown Folk Festival, a great opportunity for volunteers who would like to get involved, for singles, husband, wives, for anybody who works anyway. We'll be there for the run of the festival from Saturday, July 3rd through July 11th. Volunteers will help prepare those vehicles that are going up, transport them to the big tent up there, and then working in shifts, not working for 9 days, but working in shifts for a few hours a day, volunteers help us tell the story of these horse-drawn and motor-powered delivery vehicles, which will be displayed in our exhibit this year, to more than 100,000 people who are expected to visit Kutztown during that week. It's really something like nothing else up there. It's great fun. So here's an invitation to come and join the team. We know that you'll be glad you did. We're glad you got involved. So stop in, join the team, have some fun with us, and hey, Kutztown. Hey, the studio clock has moved around there to the point where we've got to say goodbye. We're pleased, very pleased that you joined us tonight, spent some time with us out on the cable network, whether you're in Berks County, Chester County, Montgomery County, and that you took that time to be with us this evening. Our extra thanks If you're a regular listener, we're glad to have you here, a regular viewer. And it's great tonight. We didn't give you much of a chance for phone calls, but we'll do that again next time. Hey, Dan, thanks for the very interesting look at a different era of racing.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Good stuff.
Yeah. Thank you.
Good stuff. And Mike, thanks for the insight into keeping these cars and making these cars as exciting as they ever were.
It's great. Thank you.
Maybe more exciting.
Yeah.
So until next time, thank you for joining us. Check us out on the web at BoyertownMuseum.org. And for Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles and Wheels Along the Road, I'm Ken Wells. Good night.